Dr. Richard Haven is a professor emeritus of communication.
He was one of 135 scholars who helped determine the 100 greatest American speeches of the 20th century. He is a regular guest on WFAW AM 940 Morning Magazine, host of the program Inside the University on WKCH FM 106.5, and he is the resident political analyst for NBC 15 TV in Madison. So with that, let's welcome Dr. Richard Haven.
Thank you, Brian. And it is nice to be back here at Fairhaven and to see all of you once again. Now, Brian told me because I'm a veteran Fairhaven lecturer and a media star, I get twice as much time. I think he's waving to me there or something like this, you know. Okay. It is great to be back. I when they told me the theme for this fall was standing the test of time and asked me if I wanted to be a part, I knew immediately that I did and what I wanted to talk about. And that is public speaking as an American political tradition. I'm especially interested in talking about public speaking in terms of live audiences and how it affects our political process. And so what I'm going to do is talk a little bit about the communication process and public speaking, and then we're going to take a little stroll through American history and look at some of the great speeches that have been given to live audiences that have affected this nation and our politics. And along the way, I'm going to test you some to see if you remember some of the folks I'm going to identify. So with that in mind, here we go. Public speaking is, of course, a human function. And communication is a key human function. It's one of the things that makes us different from the other species. All species communicate. But the human being communicates at an especially high level, and it is our use of symbols that especially distinguishes us from most other species. And that ability to use symbols, meaning we can use something to represent something else, allows us to have rather significant and in-depth communication. Well, public speaking is an aspect of that. And in politics, I think there's a preference for personal contact. We're certainly seeing it in this campaign for 2016 as the several thousand Republican candidates are out wanting to meet people. Some Iowa people say they've met every candidate several times. I don't know whether we want to be Iowa or not, you know, that may be a problem. But the Democratic candidates are a bit fewer, but you'll notice that all are out wanting to interact with people, to give speeches to small audiences. And that's been an American tradition for a long time. So I think it's an important part. Now, public speaking, I think, when it's done well, has a number of factors. One, it's entertaining. And of course, at one time, we'll see, it was the main form of entertainment for many people in this country. It's engaging. That is, it will bring an audience. A good speaker can engage an audience and cause them to begin to think and ponder, and of course, may affect how they see their world and the reality around it. And of course, a very effective public speaker can be motivating, persuade people, maybe change their minds, or to become more involved, or to become more active, to get out the vote, whatever it may be. So with that in mind, let's talk a little bit more about it in relation to a free society. See, public speaking happens in all societies, whether it's a totalitarian society or a free society. But in a free society, I think public speaking is a very important function. And in American society, it has been that important function from the very beginning of our republic and even before it, as we'll see. Therefore, it's tied to freedom of speech. And then, of course, it's tied to freedom of assembly. The fact that we, and I think these are our two most important freedoms, incidentally, the fact that we really believe in freedom of speech and freedom to assembly, we have the right to meet here, and nobody has the right to say in the government, no, you can't. Freedom of assembly. And then I have the right to say what I want to say. That doesn't mean they can't condemn me for it, but they should not be able to put me in jail for it. If you think about it. Now, in some societies, and we'll even see with our society at times, we've had a little trouble with that. And we've put a few people in jail throughout our history for what they said. But generally, we're pretty good at protecting the right to assemble and the right to speak. But I think they are key to a government of the people. Now, Lincoln, of course, we know, for if you were with my lecture about the Gettysburg Address, he talked about a government of the people, for the people, by the people. You can't have a government of the people if you don't have freedom of speech. You can't have a government of the people if you don't have the right to assemble. And public speaking then plays a critical role in a government of the people. So with that in mind, let's take a stroll through American history, and we're going to look back, even before the Revolution, to some examples of great speeches and how they influenced the political process or the society. And sometimes there are people inside the process, other times they're outside. So now we're going to have a quiz. I've put up the photos of four people. I call this public speaking as American as apple pie. I will tell you that none of these four people were politicians. That is, they weren't running for elective office. But yet they had speeches that influenced the society or elements of the society at their time. Now, the fellow closest to me you probably know, right? And many of you probably watched his speech on television. Of course, the most famous speech, he gave many great ones, but the dream speech. Anybody in this audience there live? No, okay. And again, for people who were there live, they talked about a different feeling than what we see in the video or what people watch on television that day. It's more of a personal contact. It affects the audience differently when you're right there in contact with the speaker, even if you're a bit distanced from him. I think it's different. Well, Dr. King, of course, his speech was rated by us as the number one speech from the 20th century. We regard that as the greatest speech in American history in the 20th century. It was a powerful speech, and it influenced a lot of people, and it continues to influence today. Now it gets a little bit harder. How about the second fellow in? Do you recognize him? That's Frederick Douglass. Now, you may not remember this speech. I don't think any of you were there. Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass gave a speech on July 5th, 1852, called What to the Slave is the 4th of July? And in that speech, he really attacked America for its sin of slavery, basically saying to the slave, there was no 4th of July. How could they celebrate? They weren't there by choice. They were enslaved. And so he, of course, was an abolitionist at the time, trying to influence from the outside the greater society to end slavery. That was a powerful speech, and it was a powerful time for abolitionists. It was not a popular speech, as you can imagine, because most everybody, even then, expected to party on the 4th of July and only talk in terms of patriotic themes. So someone to give a speech attacking the essence of the 4th of July was not well received, but that was not atypical of abolitionists. They were out to cause turmoil and create concern and dissension because they felt there were such inequities in the society. Okay, now we get harder. Who's the lady? Susan B. Anthony, very good. Now, she gave a speech in 40 times in 1872 and 1873 called Is It a Crime for a Citizen of the U.S. to Vote? So how did she come to give that speech? Well, she was in Rochester, New York, where she lived, and at the presidential election of 1872, she walked into the voting location and said, I am a citizen of the United States, therefore I have a right to vote. And she was an adult. She met all the criteria, of course, except one. And so evidently the people working the polls didn't know what to do with her. So they let her register and they let her vote. 2 weeks later, she was arrested because she had violated the law of New York State, which specifically prohibited women from voting. And so she was brought to trial. The judge would not even let her, a male, would not even let her testify. Would not let her have a jury trial, and decided on his own that she was guilty. That set her up to then begin giving this speech. And so she went around to all the audiences that she could find who would hear her to talk about, is it a crime for a citizen to vote? And of course, she was arguing that the Constitution already should allow women to vote because they are citizens. We know that was not the way the court saw it, nor the way the legislatures of Congress saw it. And although she lost her appeal, this set her up in a position to really argue the point that would finally be decided through amendment to the Constitution that was ratified in 1920. It took a while. But she was one of the early voices for women's suffrage, and this is one of the more famous speeches that came from her arrest in Rochester, New York, for voting. Now, we've had some people in this country recently suggest that people who don't vote ought to be arrested. I'm not sure that's a good idea either. All right, who's the last guy down there? This is going to be the toughest.
Mr. Cotton Mather?
It's not John Wesley.
Cotton Mather?
Nope, not Cotton Mather. He gives his speech in 1741. I'll tell you, he gives a sermon in 1741. And he's influenced. There's the name of it. And the speaker is Jonathan Edwards, one of the great preachers of the Awakening and at the time of the Enlightenment. Now, it's interesting. I go back to his speech because, remember, this is before the United States exists as a country. He's from Massachusetts. And in the 1690s, prior to that time, if you were to vote in Massachusetts, you had to be a member of the church. It was church membership that determined which men could vote. With the Enlightenment in the late 1690s, they moved from church membership to property ownership. So it's still men, wealthy men, but now it's property ownership, no longer church membership. So the churches were very influential in the colonies. And the churches depended upon which colony would determine which church was dominant. Now, most colonies wanted freedom of religion for the religion they preferred, not for the other. So if you were Catholic, which colony did you want to go to?
Maryland.
Maryland. Right. And you know, and I think the Calvins were very dominant in Massachusetts, for example. So this idea of freedom of religion, which would be enshrined in the Constitution, was really coming out of the fact that the colonies were all over the place favoring one Christian religion over another one. And here in The Sinners in the Hands of Any God is a marvelous speech, sermon, that really gives you a picture of what people saw at the time in terms of religion and the Americans' connection to God. And one of the themes that doesn't so much come out of this speech, but it emerges at this time, is the idea that the Americans are God's chosen people. That God has a special mission for Americans. And we're going to see some other examples of political speeches that work off of that belief that Americans were God's chosen people. You know, it's interesting, when Thomas Jefferson met with Lewis and Clark in the White House prior to launching them on their great journey west, Meriwether Lewis and Thomas Jefferson were speculating in a conversation what Lewis might find. And they thought he might find the lost tribe of Israel. Isn't that interesting? Not understand. Now, we know what's really out in Nevada now. It's Las Vegas. But who knows, you know. All right. So, public speaking is a part of what we do as a society. These are all people who were, in a sense, not a part of the political process, but trying to influence how people saw themselves in relation to their country, or where they lived, or how they saw themselves in relation to their God. Now we go to another example. We're going to look at great American political speeches of the 18th century. That's the 1700s, if you're having trouble with that concept. And I'm only choosing a few here for each of these. There are many great speeches. But again, you know, you're going to recognize some of these folks, and the one closest to me you ought to know. Sure. George Washington. But the interesting, you know, he had two especially noteworthy speeches. His farewell address, when he warned about, don't get entangled with those Europeans, they'll always mess you over. And he didn't quite say it that way. And his State of the Union, he, you know, started so many traditions. He gave the first State of the Union, literally, but it was also a speech to Congress. And that would be repeated until Thomas Jefferson becomes president, and he says, I don't want to talk to the Congress, and he writes them a letter. And that stayed the tradition until Woodrow Wilson in 1913. Wilson was the first president to go back into Congress and give the State of the Union. Now, if you've watched any of the State of the Unions in the last 10 years, you might wish they'd go back to writing letters. But Washington, of course, set a precedent. And here again is that idea that the president is a regular person and ought to be expected to communicate with the people's representatives in Congress. The other expectation that the nation has had for a long time, although that would change in the 20th century, was that the presidents should be ordinary folks who just go on their business like everyone else, and therefore ought to walk down the street like an ordinary citizen, not like a king. Well, we know what would bring that change. A couple of assassinations. But nonetheless, that was a tradition, and it grows out of this expectation that the president is a regular person, is a citizen, not a king. All right. Well, then the next three may be a little more difficult for you. You might recognize James Madison. Our capital city in Wisconsin is named for him. And he gave a famous speech for the ratification of the Constitution, June 3rd, 1788. In that speech, and of course he was from Virginia. Virginia was a very powerful colony, along with Massachusetts, had great influence. Pennsylvania was also pretty influential as well. But he was arguing, you know, he was an architect of the Constitution, and he was arguing for its ratification. And he was debating the guy next to him, although the guy next to him, I'll identify a different speech for him. But they were the two that debated in Virginia about whether Virginia should ratify the Constitution. And they both gave famous speeches, one for and one against. But that next guy gave another speech, Patrick Henry, give me liberty or give me death. That's, of course, I believe, the most famous American speech from the 18th century. It's the speech we most frequently recognize coming out of the American Revolution. It's actually given in 1775 at a debate in Virginia over whether Virginia should endorse what started in the New England colonies, mainly Massachusetts, involving resistance to the British. And then that's where he gives this emotional speech in which he ends it with, give me liberty or give me death. This is an ironic statement because he owned slaves. But nonetheless, he thought he was going to be enslaved by the British. Some of the ironies of history. In any case, that's probably the most famous speech from the American Revolution. Now the last guy, you know him, but you know him rather for his signature. John Hancock. You may not remember that he gave the Boston Massacre Oration, 1774. I believe the Boston Massacre actually happened in 1771, and every March 5th, to celebrate it, and remember it, you know, if you celebrate a massacre, but in any case, to remember it, they would have an orator. And he gave a very powerful oration on March 5th, 1774, about that massacre. And of course, the tensions were rising, and we know by 75, the revolution has started. So Hancock, known for his signature, that beautiful signature and handwriting on the Declaration, is also known as a speaker. And that's the speech he gave. So we go to great American political speeches of the 19th century. And now, of course, we've got 100 years we're working with. And again, there are a lot of speeches, but it's interesting. Presidents don't dominate in the 19th century the way they'll dominate in the 20th century. But there are a couple presidents up there, and you know the one in the middle. He was probably the greatest speaker of the 19th century, certainly one of the greatest speakers in American history. We talked about the Gettysburg Address in great detail. I'm not going to talk about it again. But you could talk about his Cooper Union Address when he was running for office. You could talk about his first inaugural, his second inaugural, as well as other speeches. So Lincoln was a prolific speaker and a powerful, a persuasive political man in terms of influencing the American people. But let's look at the others. How about the fellow in color there? That's a painting. You know who that is, don't you? All right. Jefferson is known for his first inaugural address, because that election in 1800 was the first true two-party election. Washington didn't like political parties. And of course, he was elected by acclamation, essentially. He was the great general of the war, and everyone was willing to support him for the most part, but they weren't always happy with what he decided. Adams was his vice president. And so after two terms, Washington shocks everybody and says, I'm done, establishing the two-term principle, which is not in the Constitution, not written anywhere, but future presidents generally followed it until Franklin Roosevelt. Well, Jefferson and Adams had a very bitter election. It kind of highlighted what we've been going through ever since. A lot of rumors, mudslinging. They did a little different then. You know, they didn't have television ads, but they had newspapers, and they had representatives who basically argued that Adams wanted to be king, and accusing someone of being a monarchist was pretty bad, all right? And then on the other side, they accused Jefferson of wanting to have a French Revolution, that is a bloody revolution, but also of carrying on with a slave. Well, history tells us that may have happened, but back then it was denied, nor was it believed to be true. It was a pretty bitter election. Jefferson wins it. And there was actually a dispute over the Electoral College at the time, but eventually Jefferson is the winner. And he walks into the Congress, to Washington, D.C., to the Capitol to give his speech. And it was a speech that was designed to heal the differences. He said, we are all Federalists, that was Adams' party. We are all Democrats, that was Jefferson's party. They're Jeffersonian Democrats. And so he uses the inaugural address to achieve unity. And that would become a tradition where the winning candidate would try to unify the nation by complimenting his opponent and trying to bring everybody in to work together. So that was a very important decision on his part. Now the other three speakers you may not recognize as well. How about the fellow between Lincoln and Jefferson? Somebody said it? That's Daniel Webster. He looks pretty mean, doesn't he? You know, he's a little older there. And we all get older, we look mean, I guess. I don't know. Is that true, Bob? I hope not. Well, Daniel Webster was a member of the Great Triumphant. And the Great Triumphant were three United States senators who dominated American political life from between 1920 until their deaths in 1952, around that time, 1950 to 52. Webster was known as the Great Orator. Then there was a senator known as the Great Nullifier. Who is that? Calhoun. John C. Calhoun of South Carolina. And then there was the Great Compromiser, Henry Clay from Kentucky. That was the Great Triumphant, the Great Orator, the Great Compromiser, and the Great Nullifier. They would fashion a compromise in 1850, especially Clay and Webster. Calhoun was opposed, but he was dying. And he would die right after his speech was delivered because he wouldn't give the speech. He wrote it. They carried him in on a stretcher, and as he lay there, someone else read the speech. And a few days later, he was dead. All right. Webster followed him, and he gave the third speech, the Compromise of 1850. And in that speech, he says, I speak not as a Massachusetts man, not as a Northern man, but as an American. And then he launched into his defense of this compromise. The compromise would pass. It probably prevented the Civil War from erupting by 1852 and kept it from happening for about 10 years. Many believe that that compromise enabled the North to become stronger and therefore in much better position to win the war in the 1860s than they would have been in the 1850s. So it was a powerful speech, but it was the swan song of the great triumphant. And the power would shift from the Senate to the presidency with Abraham Lincoln. It would shift back after Lincoln, but Lincoln would become a powerful president because of the war. What about this fellow, a younger fellow here, right next to Lincoln? Anybody recognize him? Well, again, if you were around in 1896 and attended the Republican National Convention, you would have seen him as he gave the most famous speech in American political history given at a convention. This was William Jennings Bryan, and the speech was called The Cross of Gold. Bryan was only 36 years old when he appeared on the scene as a candidate for president. That's the youngest major party candidate ever. Remember, John Kennedy was 43, I believe, as was Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt was the youngest when he became president by assassination. Kennedy, I think, was the youngest to be elected, but they were both 43, I believe. He was the youngest man to run, even though he didn't win. Now, this speech, Republican Party nominated McKinley. And McKinley, as you know, used to have a mountain named for him. Right? Okay, they just changed that. It's Denali now. And, you know, McKinley never saw Alaska. He never did anything about Alaska. Somebody who was in Alaska exploring liked McKinley, and they decided to name the mountain after him. So there wasn't a whole lot of connection there, other than people from Ohio seemed to be upset when they changed the name. All right. Bryan was a populist, and he comes out of Nebraska leading a new movement, the populist movement, mainly farmers and lower class, some laborers, but mostly not in the rural areas, not in the cities. The labor in the cities were more connected to the Republicans and to big business. But in any case, he was a populist, and the populist movement had been growing. They would eventually be subsumed into the Democratic Party, and Bryan made the decision to go into the Democratic Party to have a greater chance of winning. And that's been fairly typical of the two-party system. So the convention happens, and Bryan is one of five or six candidates, but he was not the leading candidate by any means. And he was only a two-term congressman at that point. He was not well known in most of the country. But they decided to have a debate about the gold standard. And the outgoing president was Grover Cleveland. Now, why is Grover Cleveland famous? No, Cleveland is not named for him, I don't think. But in any case, why is he famous? He did something no president has done before or after.
He said, tell the truth.
President twice, but separated.
That's right. He has two different numbers, because he won election and then lost the next election and then won again. And so he did not have sequential terms. He also was the first president to run and win the popular vote three times. He won the popular vote even though he lost the Electoral College for his first re-election. So he's unusual. But he was a big supporter of the gold standard. And Bryan was a big supporter of bimetallism. Bimetallism was popular in the West because they believed by having silver and gold, you would have inflation, and therefore there'd be more money for the producers, the farmers, the miners, and others. And so there was this big debate, do you stay on the gold standard or do you go to bimetallism? All right. So Bryan enters into this debate, and they decide to have a debate in the convention between those favoring Cleveland's position of the gold standard and those favoring Bimetal's position, including Brian. And the five speakers alternate, and Brian is the last speaker. And there really wasn't a whole lot. I mean, the Bimetalism group, the Silverites they called them, already controlled the convention. It was well known they were going to nominate their guy, but it wasn't Brian. But Brian's the last speaker, and he gets up and he gives what's called the Cross of Gold speech. And remember, in 1896, you're a powerful speaker if you've got a big voice. And orators at that time were much more dramatic than today. There were big gestures because people were looking at you from a long way away, and a little more formal language in oratory. And Brian was very good. At the end of Brian's speech, as he built up, he basically said at the end to the audience that labor will not be crucified on a cross of gold. And he was Jesus on the cross. And the audience went nuts. They became so excited that the next day they nominated him for president. It's the only example of where someone gives a keynote address and as a result of the speech wins the nomination. He was not favored by any means prior to that speech. It's one of the most interesting, powerful, and influential political speeches in American history. Well, who's this last guy? That's even tougher. Pardon me? It's not Wilson. We'll get to him in a minute. There's no presidents up there. I'm sorry, there are presidents up there from the earlier part, but no, he's not a president. Sorry. My guess is you're not going to know him. He comes from Indiana. He was a United States Senator, and he was Albert Beveridge. Anybody ever heard of him? All right. Albert Beveridge went to DePaul University in Greencastle, Indiana. It was called something different then. But in 1885, he was a student there. And I always like to talk about this because it tells you that things were a little different back then. You know, if there's a party on campus, it's always for the athletes today. They've won the championship, and so they get to ride in fire trucks, and everybody has a party and a hoopla, right? In 1885, DePaul University's representative at the Interstate Oratorical Contest in Columbus, Ohio, was Albert Beveridge. Albert was already active in the Republican Party and knew he wanted to run for office as a student. But he would go to that contest, and he would win it. And when he returned to Greencastle, he was met at the railroad station by a band and a military escort. They fired off their guns, and they carried him on their shoulders into the campus for the big party. Those were the days. Well, Beveridge would go on to be a United States Senator from Indiana, and he's famous for a speech he gave. There were a couple. One was called Old Time Politics. This one was called The March of the Flag. Beveridge was a hardcore imperialist. And one of the great debates that erupts in the early 20th century, this is 1898. And what happened in 1898 that would cause the election of 1900 not to be about the gold standard, but to be about something else? What happened in 1898? Yeah, the Maine, and then the Spanish-American War. And that war would suddenly give to the United States, as a result of its victory, the opportunity to be an imperialist power. Because in addition to Cuba becoming under the protection of the United States happened to get the Philippines. Thanks to an admiral who, under the orders of McKinley, took in the Bay of Manila, the Battle of Manila, took the Philippines from the Spanish. Now you notice who doesn't get mentioned there, that's the Filipinos. It was between the Americans and the Spanish. So now, all of a sudden, the United States has to decide, are we going to be an imperialist power like England, France, Germany, Russia? And so a great debate erupts over imperialism. Beveridge was a pro-imperialist, so was Theodore Roosevelt, as well as others. On the Democratic side, Bryan would give one of his great speeches, his acceptance speech in 1900 when he's the candidate again against imperialism. and that election would be focused on imperialism. And that debate would rage back and forth. In the speech called The March of the Flag, connecting back to those religious beliefs about the chosen people, Beveridge would talk about the idea that this, the people of this nation were destined by God to control the whole continent, sea to sea, and then to enlarge and to govern those people who were not capable of governing themselves. And of course, how were those folks mainly defined?
They were natives.
Well, they were not just natives, but they were of different races. Correct. And so he would talk about their little brown brothers weren't ready yet. We had to govern. That was part of the imperialist belief. And so that raged. And of course, for Bryan and others, they saw it as going against the very basis of the American Revolution. The idea that all men are created equal, and that the people have to decide their fate, not others for them. So that debate raged for quite a while. But that was the March of the Flag, and that was Albert Beveridge. And he was a powerful senator and a powerful voice in the early 20th century. Well, you're doing pretty well here. Let's look at our next group. One of the most interesting times in the 19th century, of course, were the Lincoln-Douglas debates. There were seven of them. They all occurred in Illinois, and of course they were about who would be elected to the United States Senate. They were not about the presidency. The Lincoln-Douglas debates were all about who would win the Senate seat. In 1858, how was the senator from Illinois determined? And this was true in the original Constitution, and therefore true of almost all states at that time, I believe. House of Representatives were by direct election, senators by the state legislatures. So when Lincoln and Douglas debated, it was trying to influence the state legislature to vote for one or the other. And actually, as we know, whichever party controlled the legislature would elect their guy. But these debates were important because they set a precedent. The idea of two candidates holding a series of debates throughout the state. They were going to have nine. There are nine congressional districts, one in each one. But they'd already had so many speeches before these. In two of them, they decided not to do those, and they chose the other seven congressional districts. Most notably, Lincoln won the popular vote, but the popular vote didn't count. Douglas won the seat because, at the time, the Democrats controlled the state legislature in Illinois. What's interesting about this is the precedent is set for later debates that we tend to expect to happen, although I like to say that what we've been watching on television are not debates. They may be reality shows, popularity contests, but you can't debate with 11 people. And you can't debate when you don't have the other side there, right? So whether we're talking about five Democrats or 11 Republicans, it's one side. And often they're debating the other side with the other side not having a voice. So it's not quite the same thing, but we call them debates. The second debate between Lincoln and Douglas was in Freeport, up here in the north. That was an area friendlier to Lincoln. Remember, Illinois was settled in the north by European immigrants coming across through Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana. Southern Illinois by people coming up from Kentucky, Tennessee, Mississippi, you know, and so on. So Indiana and Illinois are similar that way, that the North and South are very different by who settled them, and that will affect the politics, and that was certainly the case here. What's interesting about the Freeport debate is that one, in the first one, Douglas probably won that one against Lincoln. Douglas got to speak first. Lincoln spoke first in this one, and I believe, but in any case, he was able to elicit from Douglas his views on slavery and his views on how to solve the problem of slavery, and that was, of course, popular sovereignty. That would later haunt Douglas in the 60 election and cost him not only support in the Democratic Party, but any chance of beating Lincoln. So the influence of the debate on the presidential race was there, but it was deferred. It's very unusual to have a candidate incidentally lose the seat for Senate in 1858 and come back and win the presidency in 1860. You don't see that very often. Well, let's go on to great American political speeches of the 20th century. And again, there's some folks up here you'll recognize. There are even some folks you might remember because you heard them speak. Let's start with an obvious one, Robert Kennedy. Anybody hear Robert Kennedy speak live? I did too. And I was a freshman at Ball State University. And on April 4th, same day he gives this speech about Dr. King's assassination, the day Dr. King was shot, he gave a speech in Muncie, Indiana, on Ball State, that was scheduled to begin at 5 p.m. He gave it at about 6:30, I think, 6 o'clock. Well, being a good student, and the professors here know that you can't become a professor if you're not a good student, right? Being a good student, I cut classes, and I rushed to our basketball arena, which set 7,000, and I got a seat on the floor. So we were on the floor. I got there about noon. So for 6 hours, you know, I'm on the floor. And I'm waiting, you know, this is a chance to see Kennedy. I mean, I'd already seen Eugene McCarthy. You might remember he came to Whitewater, and he was introduced by Paul Newman. And many of us at Ball State went to see Paul Newman, not Eugene McCarthy. All right, that's why he used Paul Newman. But in any case, he drew about 2,500 people. By the time Robert Kennedy arrived an hour late, there were estimated to be about 10,000 people in this 7,000-seat arena. Many of us were down on the floor. And when he walked in, more surged in, and there were another couple thousand outside who couldn't get in. He was that kind of rock star. I was on the floor, and I literally could only stand because there were so many people pressing in. It was not a good feeling. You felt trapped. When he finished his speech, I went forward, not because I wanted to, but because the crowd took me with them, moving towards him. People were grabbing at him. They tore off his cufflinks. He only had one, I think, retired FBI agent and his wife with him. It was a different time. And after the speech was over, and I was walking across campus, he came riding by in a convertible, sitting on the back of the open convertible, waving to us. He went to the Muncie Airport, which is very close to Indianapolis, learns of King's assassination, flies to Indianapolis, and that evening gives this speech on the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. His speech was scheduled to be in the poorer area of Indianapolis to mainly an African-American audience. His aide said, "Senator, don't go there." He said, "No, no, I'm going." He arrives, he gets up on a flatbed, you know, not a truck, but just a flatbed. And again, remember, news spread very slow then compared to what we used to today. They didn't know King was dead until Kennedy told them. And he gave this speech, which he only put together in that time from Muncie to Indianapolis, in which he talks about the death of Dr. King and what Dr. King represented. It is a beautiful speech. It's one of his more famous speeches. What's noteworthy about it is that Indianapolis was one of the cities that had the least rioting that night. And some believe that Kennedy's words and what he said about Dr. King and what he said about nonviolence influenced that audience and maybe helped them from becoming violent. So that was one of the more interesting ones, I think, but it's one of the ones I can say I was there to see him speak that same day. And the impact on me was very different than any time I watch a speech on television. All right, how about this lady next to him? You remember her? Now, how many of you watched her keynote address in 1976 at the Democratic Convention? Yeah, and that's the speech in which she began by saying, "Something's different tonight. Something is unique tonight. I, Barbara Jordan, am a keynote speaker." It was the first time that an African-American woman gave the keynote speech. Now, she had already given a famous speech involving the impeachment of Richard Nixon as a member of the House Select Committee investigating Watergate. She had risen to attention because of that work. After this speech, there was a groundswell to make her the vice presidential nominee. I don't know that she was ever offered it, and I have a feeling she probably would have turned it down. But that speech was so effective, and it made people feel good because she talked about how things were going better, that the country was moving in the right direction. And so it's a very positive speech, and of course she's so unique, and she had this beautiful booming voice that got a lot of attention. Well, now we get to three that are harder. Do you know the lady in the middle? That's the Women's National Press Club podium that she's speaking at. She's a United States Senator, and the speech we're going to look at is given in 1950. Now, weren't many women in the Senate, and actually she got into politics because her husband died, and she took over his congressional seat, and then she got elected to the Senate. She was well regarded. She was from Maine, and she was Margaret Chase Smith. Now, what makes Margaret Chase Smith interesting to us is not just that she was a woman in the Senate, when there weren't other women in the Senate, but she gave a speech on June 1st, 1950, to the Senate called the Declaration of Conscience. And she was the first Republican to stand up and call out Joe McCarthy, who, starting in about 47, 48, had begun to really attack Democrats and others by accusing them of being communist or fellow travelers or other things. And she was really upset with the way McCarthy was behaving. And in that speech, she called him out. She was the first of several who would go on between 1950 and 1954 to challenge McCarthy directly. Why was it hard to challenge him? He was popular, not just in Wisconsin, but among Republicans throughout the country and among Americans. The fear of communism was palatable. There was this belief that the country was being infiltrated and that the communists, the Russians, were winning. And so McCarthy took hold of that, and he became very powerful. A leading Democratic senator, I believe in Virginia, attacked him. McCarthy campaigned against him, and he lost re-election. And so Republican and Democratic senators started to step back and said, whoa, be careful who you attack. Dwight Eisenhower, running for president in 52, would not speak out against him. He wanted to. He hated what McCarthy was doing to the general who had chosen him in World War II and was the Secretary of State under Truman. But Ike didn't give that speech. He wrote it, but he never gave it because they feared he wouldn't win the election if he had McCarthy against him. McCarthy was powerful. For someone to step up on the Senate floor and attack him was notable, and that was Margaret Chase Smith. Well, how about the next guy right next to her? Now, you guys all know this guy. That's Fighting Bob LaFalla. I love the hair. Okay? I was glad to get an action picture. Bob LaFalla's most famous speech, it's on the list of the top 100 speeches of the 20th century, was a speech he gave in 1917 called Free Speech in Wartime. Remember I said that a key to a government of the people is the freedom of speech and the freedom to assemble. One of the keys to freedom of speech is the right to criticize the government. Well, after World War I was declared in 1917, laws were passed making it illegal to criticize the government's effort on war. And so people were arrested and put in jail because they were thought to be fermenting actions against the war effort. This happens every so often in our nation's history, usually around war. Well, La Follette was against the war. And incidentally, the German population in Wisconsin was pretty strongly against the war. And so he had support in Wisconsin. But he had given some speeches that were seen, and he gave one in Minneapolis, that were seen as being unpatriotic and against the war effort. Now, when you go back and look at those, they weren't quite as bad as they were reported in the press. But nonetheless, some began to attack him, including in the United States Senate, where a committee was formed to investigate him, suggesting he should be expelled. And so he asked the president of the Senate permission this next day. He asked on October 5th to give a speech on October 6th. And so, again, we don't see this very often today, but both chambers came in. The place was packed because they knew he was going to give a speech. And that speech would be all about the importance of free speech in wartime, as he attacked those who would deny people who disagree with the war effort the right to speak. And it's one of the most fascinating, eloquent, powerful defenses of those who are not a part of the majority and are doing something that's not popular with the nation, especially during wartime. That's Bob La Follette. Now, who's the last guy? No. I'll tell you, there are no presidents up here. That's why it says closing presidents. Disappointing. I'll tell you, the speech he gives is in 1906, but it's either 1906 or 1911. I'll remember when it comes up here. But I'll tell you, we have a candidate for the Democratic nomination that might get compared to him. Bernie Sanders says he is a Democratic Socialist. Want to know who this guy is? Eugene V. Debs. And speech is 1910, excuse me. And of course, he was a great labor leader, but he came to the conclusion, and labor was having a pretty tough time getting a foothold in this country, that the capitalist system was the problem. And so he became a socialist, and he would eventually be the socialist candidate for president. And because he was outspoken in his opposition to World War I, he would be in jail, put in jail by the government during the war for his speeches against the war. He would be released, I think, in 1920, and he would be exonerated later on. But nonetheless, that's Eugene V. Debs. He gave a speech called Working Class Politics, in which he attacked the capitalist system for its abuses. And of course, remember, at the time, you had the golden, you know, the Gilded Age, the powerful, the, you know, the Standard Oils, you know, the Rockefellers, Carnegie and Steele, you know, the very few families controlling immense wealth. Sounds like a similar time, doesn't it? There are similarities. What's one of the big issues in this election going to be? Wage gap, wealth gap. Well, that's what he was talking about. So this is not new to American politics for us to talk about it today. It was talked about back then. And Eugene V. Debs was, you know, that labor leader who became a socialist. Now, the Socialist Party was especially successful in Milwaukee. And it included a number of mayors who were socialist. I think Frank Zeidler was the last one in the late 40s, I believe. Mm-hmm. So, there are some great American political speeches, not presidents. Let's go to the presidents. Now, you know all these guys, right? So, I'm not going to ask you to identify the name. I'm going to ask you what speech you think he may have given that I put up there. And again, there's some choices for some of them. But we'll go left to right, your left to right. And that first guy, of course, is the Rough Rider from the Spanish-American War. Teddy Roosevelt, pardon me? Now, that's the name, but what's the speech he gave that puts him in the top 100? He wasn't one of the great speakers. He was an effective speaker, but he didn't give speeches like Franklin, his distant cousin, or John Kennedy or Ronald Reagan and so on. But he did give a speech that was very powerful. He gives it, I believe, in 1906. But remember, Teddy Roosevelt, when he came back from being a Rough Rider in the charge up San Juan Hill, was so popular, he won governorship of New York. Well, he let's put it this way. Yeah, he said that. Walk softly, but carry a big stick. He carried a big stick, but he did not speak softly. One said, whenever he spoke, it was like a bull moose in heat. He was colorful. He was entertaining. All right? Now, you know, he wins governor of New York, and then it was only a two-year term. The Republicans, the party bosses, were really concerned about him because he was a reformer. And he was unpredictable. So the party boss in New York said to the Republican powers to be, including McKinley, who was up for re-election in 1900, how about putting Teddy on the vice presidential seat to get him out of New York? Teddy didn't want it. He thought it was a worthless job, but he couldn't resist all the clamor, and so he accepts it. He runs with McKinley, becomes vice president, and of course, in 1901, McKinley's assassinated, and as McKinley's chief supporter and the man who did all the fundraising, Mark Hanna, said, "Now we're stuck with that damn cowboy." And Teddy Roosevelt would go on to be one of our most entertaining, amazing presidents. Controversial and questionable, but also influential and willing to do things that were not normally accepted, including being the first president to invite a black man to walk into the White House through the front door and have dinner with him, Booker T. Washington. Southerners were livid, Southern senators and congressmen. They thought that was awful. Roosevelt didn't get it. What's wrong with that? He's a man. He's a citizen. Big deal. Yet, those were the times. So, what's the speech? Well, one of the things that Roosevelt did was to engage in the reform movement to try to curtail some of the abuses of big business. And he did some of that, but he didn't support it all. And he also was concerned about aspects of the press and the way the press was reporting about American industry. And so he said one day to the press, and Roosevelt was very good about the press and working them. He was the first one to have anything close to what we call a news conference. He didn't have news conference, but he'd go talk with the press privately and try to influence their stories. He has his aides call the leading newspapers and say, "The president's going to give a speech at the dedication of a new building in Washington. You might want to hear what he has to say." Well, that was the signal. And so there's a big audience there, and they want to know what he's going to say. And what he says is called "The Man with the Muckrake." And in that speech, he talks about the need to rein in some of the abuses of the wealthy industry owners. But he also talks about muckraking, journalists who go too far. And he invented the word muckraking as a description of a out-of-control journalist. Now, if you grew up on a farm, you know what it means to rake muck. So what was he saying about the journalists and what they were raking? But he invented the term to mean a journalist. And that's why it's one of the great speeches. But he was very good at walking the line.
What term did he invent?
Muckraking for a journalist. All right, how about the next guy? Woodrow Wilson, which speech? Now, he really has three noteworthy. Pardon me?
Wasn't it the 13 points?
Well, the 14 points. Yeah. Now, that's after the war. But I think the speech that's most noteworthy, his first inaugural, is very important. But it's his war message. The United States is trying to decide whether we're going to enter World War I. It wasn't called World War I, was it? It was called the Great War. There was no two, so they didn't call it World War I. They weren't anticipating another war, and Wilson said it would be the war to end all wars, right? Make the world safe for democracy. Wilson was torn. He had been reelected in 1916 on the platform that he kept us out of the war. But now the Lusitania is sunk, and the Germans are engaging in more attempts to control the sea lanes and therefore affecting American shipping. And finally, Wilson gives in to the warmongering that's going on in the country, especially in the press. William Randolph Hearst, for example, his newspapers were very powerful in both the Spanish-American War and I think leading up to World War I. And so he decides to go before the Congress and seek a declaration of war. Unlike his distant cousin's declaration of war in 1941, this one was not a clear case. And so he had to give a much longer speech, and he had to lay out the reasons that it made sense. It is said that he went into the Congress, he gave the speech, the Congress votes to declare war on Germany, and then Wilson returned to the White House, leaned against the mantel, and wept. He knew what this was going to do and what it meant for loss of life, and he wept. So it was a very powerful time, a very difficult time for him. We know that the Americans entering the war would turn the tide. It was pretty well a stalemate at that point, and lead to the German defeat. Wilson would go to France and attempt to negotiate the treaty and to establish the League of Nations and to hopefully win. When he comes back, he made mistakes. He didn't take any Republicans with him. The Republican Senate was tired of the war. They would never endorse the treaty nor the League of Nations. Wilson would eventually suffer a stroke while giving speeches about the 14 points and the League, and would never be the same after that. And his second wife essentially ran the White House, would control whoever could come see him. So it's a tragic time, but that message was the first time the United States had gone to war in Europe. And so that was a significant war message. Well, his distant, Theodore's distant cousin, Franklin, the Roosevelt family that Franklin was a part of were not liked by the Roosevelts that Theodore was a part of. One, they were Republicans and Democrats, but you might remember that Theodore's oldest daughter from his first wife would become one of the most powerful socialites in Washington, D.C. And that was Alice Roosevelt Longworth, I believe. And she would wield great influence. She did not like Franklin. Theodore's son, Theodore Roosevelt Jr., campaigned against Franklin in 1932 and would go on to fight in World War II and be killed in the war. But in any case, Franklin, many great speeches. The most notable here, I didn't choose his war message because it's a great speech, but it's not as influential as his first inaugural. Roosevelt's a great president partly because he faced two monumental crises. The first was the Great Depression, and the second was World War II. Franklin Roosevelt, when he was elected in 1932 over Herbert Hoover, the fact that he won election was not surprising. Hoover was terribly unpopular, not surprising, because the country was in shambles. It's been estimated by that time that the unemployment was probably up towards 30 to 35%. Banks had failed, farms had been foreclosed, industries were shuttered. The country was a mess. Many people thought that the country itself was going to fail, that the government would go under, and that there would be a revolution, that the turmoil was so significant it could not survive. Roosevelt stepped to that podium in March of 1933 and gave a speech remembered, of course, for the line, "We have nothing to fear but fear itself." And I think what he meant by that was, the government will not fail. We have nothing to fear but the fear that's overwhelming us. We can make it through. His speech was on the radio as well before a large live audience. And the White House was flooded with telegrams. And people said, in many of them, they just felt better. They didn't know why, but they just felt better. He gave them hope. He didn't have any details, generalities. He would go on, of course, to do a lot of different programs, and he would try a lot of things to try to bring the Depression under, and would not succeed until World War II, which would finally end the economic problems of the Depression. But he gave people hope, and he helped to navigate the country towards a new deal, as he called it, that enabled labor to be more powerful, put some protections for people not to be harmed, such as, and we have them today, don't we? The FDIC, Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. Before that, if you had a savings account at First Citizens or Commercial Bank and the bank failed, you lost it. Too bad. That's why that came to exist, so you could have faith that your money would be there. All right? And of course, there were a number of other things that were done that would change the fabric of the nation. The people who opposed Roosevelt were not the Republicans that gave him the most trouble. It was the left wing of his party. Most notably, a senator from Louisiana, Huey Long, one of the great demagogues of all time. There's a story told about, and Huey Long gave a couple of great speeches. There's a story told about Huey Long. He was running, I think, in the 1920s. I think he was governor first, then senator. And he was running for re-election, and he went out to a Catholic parish. And he drives out with his driver and gets out, and he talks to the Catholics in the audience about his Catholic grandparents.
What's the man's name?
Huey. Huey Long. He was the governor and senator of Louisiana, okay? And so he's talking to them, and he tells them about his grandparents who were Catholic and going to Mass with them. Now, he wasn't Catholic. So he gets back in the car, and his aide says, Governor, I didn't know you had Catholic grandparents. He said, no, I don't. You can get away with that because there was no social media. Nobody could pull out a cell phone and say, here's what he said, right? And word didn't quite spread the same way. Anyway, he was colorful. Roosevelt steered the country in some ways on a middle course. It wasn't seen by those who opposed him in the Republican Party, but compared to the far left that would really have ended the capitalist system, he saves it in many ways. Because again, the turmoil, and some of you probably remember the late 30s, and the times were a bit different than they would be later in the 20th century. Well, you guys know the next guy. A lot of great speeches. Effective politician, first Catholic president, not the first Catholic candidate. That was Al Smith. First Catholic president. All right? Yeah, I just marvel today when I see all the presidents want to meet the Pope. And they invite him to speak to the Congress. Can you imagine that in 1960? Opponents to Kennedy said that if Kennedy's elected, the Pope will move the Vatican to New York and make the decisions for Kennedy. That was the fear. A little different time. But the speech I want to highlight here is his first his only inaugural address. It's his most famous speech. It's beautifully crafted. It's powerful. We remember some of the powerful words. One of the things that I thought most interesting about that speech is he talked about a new generation tested by war, taking power. And of course, he was of that new generation. We call them now the World War II generation. But Eisenhower, before him, and Roosevelt were of the 19th century. Kennedy was the first president born in the 20th century. And so the World War II generation would start with Kennedy and essentially end with H.W. Bush. Hold the presidency for a long time. Jimmy Carter's a quasi-World War II. He was, you know, involved in the military, but not in the war, I think. But everybody else was of the World War II generation, and even he is, actually, too. So that's a powerful generation, the most powerful generation since the Civil War generation, which would also hold the presidency for a long time. So the inaugural address is wonderful, and of course the most famous quote is, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. He also said, ask not what the world can do for you, but what you can do for the world. Out of that comes the Peace Corps. All right. But there are just, you know, he spoke almost entirely on foreign policy in that speech, not on domestic issues. And of course, communism and the concern about the Cold War was probably one of the reasons. So the last guy is Ronald Reagan, one of the other great speakers of the 20th century presidents. He, like Kennedy and Roosevelt, had the most speeches on the list of the top 100. And there are many to choose from. The speech, actually, that was ranked the highest for him, number 7, was his eulogy for the astronauts. And he gave that, he wrote that, they wrote the speech within hours after the space shuttle blew up, and he delivered it on television that night, speaking at times to the school children who had watched it blow up live. But that speech was not given to a live audience, so I didn't choose it. The one I chose, you may or may not know, is called the Evil Empire Speech. Given March 8, 1983, and Reagan spoke to the meeting of the evangelicals, I think in Texas. But at that meeting, this was, of course, a new emerging constituency for the Republican Party. And they really began to appear in the 70s and were powerful by the 80s. And we think of them as the religious right today. Well, Reagan was working the audience. And in that speech, he tapped into a popular movie series, Star Wars. And he named the Soviet Union the Evil Empire, tapping into, again, the Star Wars film. And what's fascinating about that, it was a good example of using popular language to craft a rhetorical position that played well with his live audience and generally played well with Americans. And yet, only a few years later, he would be sitting down with the so-called emperor of the evil empire negotiating. Ronald Reagan was a practical man. But he knew how to use language to make a point. And that was a powerful and effective speech. Well,
trust but verify.
Trust but verify, one of his famous statements that helped him get elected over Jimmy Carter.
Reagan was born in northern Illinois, not too far away from here, right?
I think that's right. He went to college, I know, at Eureka in Illinois, but I think you're right. That was in, I think of more central Illinois, but it's in Illinois in any case. Well, there you go. Some great speeches. And so let's talk a little bit more about public speaking and why I think speeches like that play such an important role. How many of you have ever heard a president speak live? Okay. I've heard a president twice. I've heard presidential candidates many times. I actually heard Bill Clinton in 93 and I believe in 96 give a speech in Washington, D.C. And I mention that only because I've watched many presidents give speeches on television. But to see and hear the president maybe shake his hand is a very different experience. Regardless of the politics of the time, there's something special about being in that room. You either feel like you're in the safest place in the world or you're going to blow up any minute. Because I remember I was at a conference with Galen Greenhill. I was his assistant. And Bill Clinton came to speak to us. And so there were only about 500 of us in the audience. It was a small group. And it was at a banquet. And we had to go through all of the security to get in the room. All these guys were walking around who were bigger than me with something coming out of their ear. And they were wearing trench coats. I figured they weren't there for the educational conference. Okay. So there's something special about the live audience, and especially when it's a very powerful person or a very important time or a unique situation. And so those live opportunities are different. Back in 2008, because I happen to have connections with WFAW, I got media credentials to go to Milwaukee when they hosted both Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton at the same event. And so I got a chance to hear first Hillary Clinton speak and then Barack Obama, not knowing which one would become president or neither would become president. That was unusual. And so I find events like that fascinating. What do we conclude? Well, what makes it so special to the political arena? Here's what I think. One, I think people like to look candidates in the eye, and by that I mean be in the same room, talk to them if possible, judge them. It's the way we judge character. We try to size up the person. There's a story told of Grover Cleveland. Grover Cleveland was the second heaviest president. Who was the heaviest?
Taft.
Yes, a story told of Taft. When he walked out to swim in the ocean, a couple kids were playing, and one of the kids said to the other, we can't be in the ocean anymore. The president wants to use it. Well, Cleveland was the second heaviest, and while president, he went on a speaking tour. And he spoke from the back of the train. Then he walked down to meet some of the citizens. There was an old fella standing there. And Cleveland walked up, and the fella said, "You're the first president I've ever seen speak." And Cleveland said, "Well, what do you think?" And the fella said, "I think you're a whopper." I think the second aspect about public speaking to a live audience involves a test of intelligence, or what we call sagacity. We're looking at soundness of judgment. We do that with media presentations as well, but I think in the public speaking setting, we're looking for that. We don't want scripted all the time. We want to be able to judge the person. Are they capable? We look at how effective they use language. How articulate are they? We believe an articulate person, I believe, is a more effective leader. That may not always be true, but I think people will think that and will make that judgment. We test whether someone is capable of governing. We look at their demeanor, their outward behavior. Can he or she handle the pressure? Do they seem to be knowledgeable? We make all kinds of judgments as we listen to the speech about the candidate. You agree? I think we're measuring and we're looking at things like that. Now, part of that depends upon how we see the person when we first walk in, if we know them well. If we don't know them well, that makes a difference. But not, or do we agree with them or not? But nonetheless, I think we judge. I think it's a test of leadership. Can that person inspire or motivate? Can they lead us? One of the tests about the presidency that really I think a lot of people, no matter how they see the candidates, do make at some point is, can they picture that person in the Oval Office? And to give you an example, I think that's probably one of the measuring sticks that may be a problem for Donald Trump. Can you picture him in the Oval Office? His task is to convince people that they should see him in a positive light in that situation. But I think people do that. Can that person be trusted to be the president? I think the in-person experience versus the mass media experience is important in distinction. The impact on the live audience tends to be more personal than through media. Media is cold. Live is warm. And I think we like that. And we seek it out where we can get it. And finally, I think it's more significant. That's why in Iowa and New Hampshire, the candidates keep showing up and walking around and visiting everybody, because they know those voters want to have a personal experience. And, you know, Wisconsin's primary comes later. We don't get quite as many opportunities like that anymore. We used to. But that times have changed. But I think we do yearn for that at times. So that's public speaking. I think it's why it's still very important to have our elected officials speak to live audiences. I think as Americans, we expect it. I think we see it as an essential part of government of the people. And I think that we will not likely lose that anytime soon. Even though we have social media and mass media, we will still seek out the person-to-person contact, the live audience. That's why I think it stood the test of time.